own personal experiences where you can go out of body or you tap into other realms and other dimensions, it's like, all right, if it's my time, it's my time. And, you know, there's tragic deaths that happen all the time. You know, there's murders, there's these car accidents. And, you know, how many times have you heard people say, well, when your time is up, it's up, you know? And I think you just kind of have to face each day as it comes. And, you know, when you realize a little bit more about death or, you know, what may happen, then I think that you start living a little more in the present.
It is interesting that you know, I'm getting on in age and off and on, you know, and when I'm thinking about it, it's like, you know, okay, like my dad, he died at 96. And I saw him a week or two before, and you know what he said to me? He said, I know I'm going to die. He said, what's taking so long? Anyway, he had such a cavalier attitude about it. I do find so many of the old folks have a more cavalier, and the cavalier of the youngsters is, it's cavalier until they find out that they're going to die. I don't mean if they got AIDS or something like that, but the fact that at some point, you're not going to be what you thought you were in this body, you know? What were you, right. Of all the people that you interviewed, all the people that are the people part of the show, what to you, both of you, if it's different, what was the most memorable, the most impactful person to talk to on the video?
That's a really tough question because everyone really brought something so dear and personal, I think, to both of us.
Right. I don't want to put you in that space.
But I do think that what kind of sold us both was really Tom Campbell, the nuclear physicist, because, you know, you can have a lot of these experiences and, you know, you can talk to people and the different things that they've gone through, but he really comes from a scientific model. And when you can tie the science into some of this and see that, wow, okay, there really is some, you know, proof in the pudding here, I would say that probably for us has been such a memorable experience, so much so. I mean, he was such a patient man. He gave us 9 hours of footage. You know, we were there for a day and a half. Wow. And he sat with us for 9 hours talking with us. And after we went through all of his footage, we said, you know what, we need to do a documentary just on Tom. And he's agreed to that, actually. So we do plan on going ahead and doing that. And we went to Texas, Austin, Texas, this year and did some filming on some of the lectures that he gave. And we're also going to be traveling to London in October as well to continue to document him because he has so much expertise and comes from such a scientific realm. And I think people who are out there that are more of the extreme skeptics, they need that science. They need that background. Mm. So that would be for me. Mike, what about you?
Yeah, I'd have to say the same about, you know, with Tom, you know, and also experiencing the Monroe Institute, they were very generous and pretty much having to run the place for a day. And it was just, I guess there is a definite different kind of energy in at the Monroe Institute. And it's very peaceful, it's very tranquil. But at the same time, you're getting something from it. And, you know, it wasn't until probably, you know, a few hours after we left that it kind of hit you that there's this whole science just on consciousness, and you know these people are on the forefront of that science. And it was just, you know, a fascinating day, just to spend the day with Skip and Paul and Patty at the Monroe Institute.
I have one question that's always been outstanding with me, and every time I have someone dealing with the afterlife or past lives, I'd like to see if they can answer this one. In my physical body, I look with my eyes. I smell with my nose, and I hear with my ears, and I touch with my skin. In the afterlife, I hear people saying they see things, they hear things, they smell things, and they don't have a nose or eyes or anything. What from your interviewing these people came through on that, if anything?
I think that's talking a lot about, you know, just energy and thought form. You know, if you think about your dreams, kind of the same thing. You know you're interacting with these people in your dreams, but do you ever actually see people talking in your dreams? Do you actually ever watch their lips move? It's more through, you know, thought transference and energy exchange. And when you're free from the physical body, you're able to interact at a much higher vibration and still be able to have that same experience.
Well, you know, I remember talking with Bob Monroe of the Monroe Institute when I was publishing New Frontier magazine. And he tells me this story because he used to talk very, very straight out, you know. And, of course, we all remember seeing Ghost. But he mentions that this young fellow who was Puerto Rican, handsome fellow, who was very, let's should we say, very precocious in an intimate kind of way with women, you know. And he could see through walls and everything, and he went to... well, I guess he thought he was like going to rape this beautiful woman. And he jumped from like the third story and he saw her down. And of course, he went down like 100 feet under the ground because there wasn't any form. And I heard stories that unless we drop our attachments before we exit, it's a very painful thing. But we'll find out when we get back. My guest today have put together a new DVD, part of the Path series called The Afterlife. And you want to see that, and you want to go to their website, which is thepathseries.com. We get back, we're going to talk more. Our telephone number here, you get your last. We're back with our guest today, who are dealing with the subject, Michael Habernig and April Hanna. What do you really want this film to achieve? What do you want people to get from it?
Well, you know, I think we're really hoping that if people come in with a certain belief system when they're watching this film, that it'll open their mind and possibilities to something else. You know, like we've been saying all along, we really want the fear that's associated with death in our culture to dissolve after watching this. We want it to have a great impact where not only will the fear of death dissolve, but people will feel motivated to feel like they do have a purpose and a plan while they are here now, and to just become better human beings and, you know, act in such a way that they feel like they are fulfilling their time here while they are here in the physical body, and then to know that when they do depart and they transition, that they're going to have other challenges and more lives to live in different types of, you know, we'll call it reality frames, as we've picked up that language from Tom Campbell. So I think those are some of the big things that we really want people to take away from it.
On the line, we have a caller. His name is Chip from Arden, North Carolina. He says he has a question for the callers. Well, for the guest, probably. All right, Chip, hi. How are you? Welcome to Virato Live.
Thank you very much.
Oh, it's a female. I'm so sorry.
That's okay. That's okay. Okay. Everybody thinks that.
Okay. So you have a question for our guests?
Yes. If you have a loved one who is nearing death and who is desperately afraid to pass, how do you help that person?
Well, you know, I think part of it, whenever you are with a loved one who is getting ready to transition and in part, I think the best gift that you can give them is being present with them in the moment. And, mm-hmm. you know, it's a little hard to answer the question. I mean, is the person that you're referring to, are they of sound mind right now? Are they cognitively
yes.
stable?
Yes.
Or, mm-hmm. And what would you say is her biggest fear?
I'm not sure, but this person has been holding on and holding on and holding on. I'm really not sure what it is. And, you know, this person is ready to go, and yet there's that fear. And when it was my mother, I was able to help her pass, just as you said, by being present. But with
right.
my dad, it's been very much harder. And, you know, each day the physical body is having more and more challenges.
Chip, it would seem to me that you want to immediately order a copy of this DVD.
Yes. Oh, well, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes.
And you
yes.
know what? The other thing, too, I would also offer to you would be to check out the Monroe Institute website, because when I was there, I had just started volunteering for hospice, and they have some great hemi-sync music that can mm-hmm. really put those who are dying at ease and help them to transition. I'm not sure if this family member of yours would be, you know, willing to slap on a pair of headphones and, you know, just kind of relax and listen to some of this hemi-sync music. But I think the other part of it, too, is to honor where this person is at. Obviously, they are holding on.